You'd be forgiven for thinking the song you're listening to was forged in the dust bowls of the American West, but you'd be wrong. This song was recorded 3,000 miles away in the Nashville of the North, Shetland's Borough Isle.
He says, if you've got money, I'll see that you don't walk. I've been gone.
When Thomas Fraser died in 1978, he was remembered only as a shy lobster fisherman, unknown beyond Shetland shores. 30 years later, he's been hailed as the most important voice in the history of British country music. He's been honoured at Nashville's Country Music Hall of Fame. His fourth CD has just been released, and he's celebrated annually in a festival in his native Borough Isle.
I know it's too late, dear old daddy, to repay for the sorrow and care.
He'd be happy that people are still listening to his music and everything, but probably I think Mum and Dad would both be a bit more than a bit shocked at where it's all gone, and especially what's happening at this moment in time.
We were staying with our hosts in Lerwick and having dinner one night, and they were playing this amazing music in the background, and our host says to me, where do you think this singer might come from? And I wasn't really sure. I was torn between Tennessee and Georgia, you know, so I told him that. I thought it was recorded in the 30s, maybe. He's not only sort of a man out of place, but a man out of time, in a way.
American daylight bombers were busy again today.
Thomas first fell in love with American music during the distant turmoil of World War II.
This is the American Forces Network Europe.
Good morning, Captain. Good morning, Shine. Do you need another mule skinner out on your new mud line? Doodly-dee.
Thomas had been yodeling since he was 6 years old, but he'd struggled to find an appreciative audience. So when he first heard the voice of country blues legend Jimmy Rogers, it was a source of great joy.
I can pop my initials on a mule behind.
By the age of 10, Thomas had mastered a variety of musical instruments. Developing a particular attachment to his guitar, friends and family were quick to recognise his musical talents, and after being gifted a gramophone by a neighbour, the teenage Thomas went out and bought every Jimmy Rogers 78 in Shetland. Rogers was the most popular country artist of the day, and Thomas was obsessed with mastering his finger-picking guitar style. His parents were less enthusiastic and banished him to the upstairs of their single-storey home.
I suppose there was a certain affinity between country people here and country people across there. The same hardships, the same fight against nature, the same everything, and the same difficulties, the same poverty, the same everything. And these songs seemed to move across the Atlantic quite easily. There were an awful lot of Shetlanders going into every port in the world in the Merchant Navy. And these boys were picking up different kinds of records, bringing them back here, saying, oh, this would be a good in for Thomas.
The Atlantic didn't just provide a bounty of musical treasures. It was the harsh, unforgiving environment in which the people of Shetland earned a living, and Thomas was no exception. By the age of 18, he'd been at sea for 2 years, working on everything from lobster boats to ocean-going trawlers. But it was still a painfully shy teenager who reluctantly emerged to perform at his sister Betsy's wedding.
And in that days, it would have been post-war, so the weddings in Borough Isle were often held in their house, in a really small living room, so you just wonder how everyone could fit. So he was quite shy, and he played in the closet, and all the people were dancing in the living room. So they couldn't see him, but they could hear him.
He never sort of played at the concert. He used to play in the public hall. We had teenagers' dances, and he would come and play the fiddle sometimes and sing a few songs. After he was had a dram, he would have a... He was very shy, and he'd have a dram. He'd get a bit of courage, and he'd come and play. And we used to love it when he came, because there was always plenty of life. He was always hoofing and banging his feet and jumping around the stage. And it was just like a real Wild West Cajun-type fellow.
Thomas was as comfortable on the fiddle as he was on the guitar, and word of his talent spread quickly round the aisles. But although there are tales of him raising the roof whenever he performed, you were more likely to hear him singing at the Creels than live on stage.
When the wind was northerly and you were walking along the sandy face that was coming into Hamnavoe, you'd be walking out on a fine summer's night, and Thomas would probably be in the north end of Papa, going along the shore, hailing Creels. You could hear him. You could hear the engine. You could hear him above the engine. You could hear him singing away, quite the thing. And yodeling, that was commonplace. He used to say, "I heard you singing at the back of Papa." "Yeah, yeah, yeah. Here to hear you sing song, man. Here to sing when I'm off." He says, "It just passes the time, man."
It's raining here, storming on the deep blue sea. It's raining here, storming on the deep blue sea. Lord, I wake a tornado would blow my blues away. Wake a tornado, blow them away.
But if you really wanted to hear Thomas in his musical element, you had to weigh anchor and journey to his setter home for a traditional Shetland session.
The whole way going there, we'd be singing. We'd go past the male corner, and we'd look across the setter, and Eddie would say, "I wonder if Thomas is singing just now, for waiting for us again." Oh, it was great. Great hoose to go to.
The setter sessions were strictly teetotal, with Thomas's wife Phyllis keeping a tight rein on the flow of liquid refreshments.
"Aye, Mississippi River, the water's so deep and so wide."
We were just young lads, you know, and we had sort of beat-up cheap guitars, and there were not much money about then. To go to Thomas, he had guitars, mandolin, the fiddle, and he had the tape recorder, of course. That was a new invention sort of thing, mm-hmm. You know. So that was a big attraction to us.
For those unable to make it along to the house, the modern world was about to lend a helping hand. In 1953, when electricity finally came to Burra, nobody greeted it more heartily than Thomas, who went straight out and bought himself a state-of-the-art reel-to-reel recorder. From this point on, Thomas never performed in public again. If you wanted to hear him play, all you had to do was send him a request, and he would make you your very own recording.
Thomas would receive requests to record songs from various people, from family members or friends, and these requests would come from all over Shetland, sometimes abroad. Usually the reel-to-reel would arrive by post at Thomas's house, and it would have a recorded message on the start of the tape, usually some general chit-chat, and then it would get to the point and would ask for a specific recording from Thomas of a popular song of the day, maybe a Hank Williams tune or something like that. And Thomas would duly oblige. He would wind the tape back to the start, press record, and quite often do them a whole tape. So there would be, you know, maybe 20, 30 songs on that one tape, and he would post it back. He was recording all the time, for either for himself or for other people. So it was a music factory, this outer house, to be honest.
Yeah, we left for a hard week at the sea night, and I would take me Hamie Thomas Fraser tips aboard my boat, and I would take me 20 tins of beer with a fine Saturday afternoon, and just set off cruising with me boat with Thomas Fraser tips, turned the volume aboon the noise of the engine, and it just was that good to hear him, the sound of his voice and that, and I just cruised around for a while of the afternoon and listened to Thomas.
I think when he sings about rolling down the Mississippi, in his head, I think he actually is rolling down the Mississippi, even though he's never been there. And when he talks about being out in the prairie, he's got an image in his head of himself as a cowboy riding out there. And he chooses these songs because he loves them, but also because he identifies with them. You know, maybe being out in the creel boat and the sound out there is not that different being away out in the prairie on the back of a horse rounding up the cattle.
Thomas's recording conditions were in stark contrast to the wide open spaces of the prairie lands. The spirit of the South being evoked in the tiny bedroom he shared with his wife Phyllis.
I think probably part of the reason why those tapes still exist is not because of Thomas. It's because of Phyllis, his wife. She rescued the tapes, and whenever she was in Larry, she got them in another one. And she's sealed that up and dated it and whatnot and kept it.
However, the contribution of younger family members didn't always improve the quality of the recordings.
Well, that was me in the background there, aged about 1.5, 2 year old. That was recorded in the bedroom where Mum and Dad stayed, in the house belonging to my grandparents, etc. So the recording facilities weren't exactly ideal at that time. Lots of interruptions.
In an attempt to find peace and quiet, Thomas would record by night, frequently trying out new recording techniques right through till dawn.
He experimented with double tracking, overdubbing himself back in the 50s before hardly anybody else had thought of that. Really, he was quite a technologically adventurous person. You know, like a lot of musicians, he was into playing around with the best possible guitars and effects. And I'm sure if he was around now, people have said this to me, he'd be walking around with an iPod plugged in the whole time and 5,000 Jimmy Rogers songs on.
In a vine-covered track in the mountains, bravely fighting the battle of time, there's a dear one who's wild at last sorrow. Is that silver hair, Daddy?
Although Thomas preferred to work alone, Arthur Pottinger is one of a small band of local musicians who recorded with him.
When we were recording, it was very difficult to get the record sounding quality that we were wanting. We were talking and thinking in terms of this wonderful sound that you could get when you were in the toilet. We were always trying to get that little bit of presence, that little bit of echo.
When I got to that river, thought I wanted to die.
That's how we tried to do our recordings.
I mean, I'm not wanting to dispute Arthur's story, but we didn't actually have a bathroom in the house until about 1969, I think, 70. So, unless it was after that, I'm unsure.
The cliffs of Fulla are only 20 miles from Burra's shores, but in Thomas's world, they may just as well have been on the American Pacific coast. Eric Eisbester had never left Fulla, and he and Thomas never met. It was up to Thomas's nephew Bobby to act as go-between on what has gone on to become one of Thomas's most cherished recordings.
Back in 1968, then, Bobby Fraser was here in Fulla. His sister used to be the nurse here, and he had a fairly large, old-fashioned tape recorder in here. And he recorded quite a few songs, which I sang at the time, and I did a version of Over the Rainbow, which he took back, and Thomas Fraser heard it and he seemed to like the version, so he recorded it. So here goes.
Somewhere over the rainbow's way, up high, there's a land that I've heard of once in a lullaby.
When I got back, I made a duplicate of the tape and I took it out to Thomas in Setter. And he played it and he thought it was great, just beautiful singing. And I said to him, I said, what do you think of the song Over the Rainbow? Oh, very good. Every song that he sang was good. But he says, it's not my kind of singing. He says, I'm country and western. And I kind of pestered him. I says, Thomas, you can sing it. I would like you to sing it. Please, please make this recording. Well, he says, I'll think about it.
Somewhere over the rainbow, bluebirds fly. Birds are flying over the rainbow. So why can't I? Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me. That is where you'll find me, somewhere over the rainbow.
Despite his passion for recording, Thomas remained first and foremost a hard-working creelman, going out in bad weather and risking his life on a daily basis to feed his family.
I always mind him coming in one night and we come into the house and he's sitting with his hands like this. And I said, what's wrong with you, Thomas? He says, I've been pulling creels all day and I can't get my fingers to straighten up. He says, they're the same shape as the rope. I mind him saying that. And then eventually we got, after a few cups of tea and whist playing around and playing guitars and singing, then he would start and then he would play. But it must have been a hard life.
Well, family life was very hard in that days, not just for us, but for lots of people. Making your living at the creels wasn't easy, because it really was all dependent on the weather. In the winter time, there was lots of days that wasn't weather to go at all. So they made a living with knitting machine. That was their income over the winter, along with the craft, of course.
He used to get down terrible. That's when he would disappear to the North Gower Setter, a small inlet just north there. It was just out of the sight of the house. Many a time we'd hear him sitting there singing. And he was probably doing that to get rid of the blues, because he used to take the blues a lot. He was very, very high strung. He was full of energy. He wanted to do more. I always mind him saying, I wish I could do more with this guitar. I wish I could do more with my recordings.
When Radio Shetland came on the air, then they wanted local people to sing and that. I said, Thomas, that's a good chance for you to learn about, get your music all over Shetland. Oh, yeah. He said, it'd be good, he says. But it never happened. He was terrible, terrible sorry. And I said, how do you get on with your tapes? I never came on the Radio Shetland. No, he said, they didn't put it on. He said, okay, they didn't think that I was good enough. And he says, he went into his box where he kept the tapes and says, here's the recording that I made, me and May singing. You can keep it.
We did quite a bit of singing together. Always regret we didn't do more, and because obviously you never realise that the time was going to be so short.
Just like a blind man I was.
In October 1973, Thomas was involved in a fishing accident that all but claimed his life.
I was working in the shop at Hamnavo, and we got a phone message from Bridgend to say that Thomas had got wrecked on West of Skerry. He'd been on the Skerry maybe an hour by that time.
What Thomas told me was there were one big stone in the middle of this reef, and he got his arms around it. He said a prayer to himself. He said, oh, he says, this is the end and that. And then he saw this fishing boat coming and it might be a bit of a hope. No, he says, that might be a bit of hope.
So the saviour was the Scotch Wing when the Scotch Wing came and fired that rocket line across.
We were lying on the lee side. We roared to him to tie the rock to him and go to the edge and jump and we'd pull right away.
And they were pulling in from the Scotch Queen, you see. And he says, I was tumbling over into the water, just gasping. He says, sometimes under the water, and then my head could come up, and I would get a gasp of air, and they pulled me aboard the boat.
We should set off full speed. We took Damon Dow to the pier, and we met the doctor at the pier.
After that accident, he says, they'll get me yet. And I says, Thomas, what's the mean with that? Well, he says, very near shave the last time, with the boat going on the Skerry and going upside down and seeing the boat being broken up in front of my eyes and hearing the last dunk-dunk of the engine going under the water. He says, they'll get me yet. I said, don't be silly.
I'll sing my lonely heart.
But Thomas's premonition was to prove tragically correct. In July 1977, he was knocked unconscious by a blow from his boat's jib arm. It was an accident from which he would never fully recover, and he died in January 1978. He was 50 years old. Thomas's voice went unheard for a generation, until it was eventually rediscovered by his grandson, Carl Simpson. Shortly before his death, Thomas had asked Bobby Fraser to look after his tapes, and it's him we have to thank for being able to listen to them today.
Anyway, I had lay in my house for 30 years. Then one day, May and Carl came to the house, and he set tape recorder on, and he would listen and listen.
And I can't quite describe this, the feeling I had when the sound came out of the speakers. I was bowled over, really. It sounded so authentic, like an old blues artist from the 20s or 30s. And at the time, I was listening to people like Robert Johnson, and here, coming out of the speakers with this amazing sound, but it was my own family, it was my own personal Robert Johnson, so I was amazed. I thought I must preserve these tips because they were becoming very fragile, dusty, and parts of them was broken. I thought this will be lost forever unless we do something.
I've done a lot of work restoring the, particularly the early blues and jazz recordings, people like Robert Johnson, Charlie Patton, Blind Lemon Jefferson. But you find in Thomas's recordings that same vitality, same urgency and same originality in his performances and the way he approaches the material, as well as quite often a similar sound.
Because Thomas posted out his tapes by request, countless recordings have been unearthed from all over Shetland. Over 1,000 have emerged so far, and still the new discoveries keep coming.
Thomas Fraser on KRCB Radio 91 FM.
Thomas had never even performed live in Shetland's capital, Lerwick. But in 2004, he was paid the ultimate tribute when his relatives were invited to Nashville to perform in his honour at the Country Music Hall of Fame.
I'd just like to say what a great honour it is for us to be here and how proud we are that, on behalf of my father, that his music is being played here. It's just absolutely amazing. Thank you very, very much.
Thomas's musical circle was now complete.
When you wrote me, you said you were sorry, and you still want me for your friend.
I mean, who would have thought that his recordings would have taken Carol to Nashville, where they were interested in how their music had managed to cross the Atlantic to find its niche in something which you couldn't see on the map of the world and have an influence on this crofter fisherman. I mean, it was an astounding surprise when they heard Thomas singing Peach Picking Time in Georgia. They were stunned, and Thomas would have been absolutely astounded at the effect.
He could sing anything. His voice was just phenomenal. You just need to listen to it. And just imagine if he'd have had teeth, how much his pronunciation might have been a bit better. But we often used to laugh about Thomas with his teeth out. I wonder where this song's going to sound right tonight.
I go over to the cemetery and I see a stone there and I just look and I says, Thomas, if you're there, I says, I hope you're still singing when you're up by. Well, that's it. No more to be said.
In that beautiful land, on that far away strand, no storms with their blast differ from the streets